Discount rates. So why a discount rate? Under the current lease accounting standards, if you do not have any capital leases, or if we put it another way, if you don't have any operating leases in your portfolio and you've yet to adopt, you don't currently have to contend with a present value calculation. So for those of you who have not, who are new to this and you only have had operating leases or short-term leases in the past and not have to worry about discount rates and calculating the present value of a liability, then you may be wondering, what is the need for a discount rate? All right, from a GASB 87 standpoint, I would say in terms of the definition, it's a lot more aligned with ASC 842. And the guidance states in paragraph 23, if the interest rate cannot be readily determined by the lessee's estimated incremental borrowing rate, which is an estimate of the interest rate that would be charged for borrowing the lease payments amount during the lease term, should be utilized. So what is stating here in summary is that you should be using the implicit rate within your contract, but if that is not readily determinable and you're able to back that up, then you are allowed to use your estimated incremental borrowing rate to calculate the present value of your remaining lease payments or receivables. And just as a reminder, because of the delay for GASB 87, that's been pushed back to 18 months from the original effective date. So you guys are a little lucky there if you're reporting under GASB. And under GASB 87, there is no assumption of a risk-free rate because GASB 87, the board had the opinion that there is no, leases cannot exist without risk, therefore canceling out the viability of a risk-free rate to be used.
All right. And GASB 87 here, this is actually not defined. The implicit rate itself is not explicitly defined within GASB 87. However, the standard itself does reference statement number 62 for an explanation of that rate. And so that's the rate that when you apply it to your minimum lease payments, excluding a portion of payments representing executory costs that are being paid by the lessor, together with any gain thereon, and the unguaranteed residual value accruing to the benefit of the lessor, would cause the present value at the beginning of the lease term to equal the fair value of the lease property at the inception of the lease, minus any investment tax credit retained and expected to be realized by the lessor. So this is similar, and we'll take a look at the calculation in the next slide. All right, so comparing this to the other ones we've seen here, we still have the present value of the lease payments, we still have a present value of an unguaranteed residual value, but then you also have here the fair value of the asset minus the related investment tax credit, similarly to 842. Now we wanna take a look at an example here, and what we're gonna do is we're gonna actually utilize Excel using their internal rate of return or IRR function with some background information. So let's just assume for our example here, these are the facts. So we have a lease that the lessor is charging the lessee $4,000 annually, and this payment is made directly to the lessor at the beginning of each year. We're also gonna make the assumption in this example that the lease is starting on 1-1 of 2020, and that is a five-year lease term. Now, additionally, some other factors here is that as of the lease commencement date, the fair value of the asset being leased is $15,000. Additionally, at the end of the lease term, the lessor has expected that the fair value of the asset they're gonna receive back, or we can call this the unguaranteed or expected residual value, that's estimated to be $1,000 at the end of the lease term. Now, additionally, the lessor has incurred initial direct costs of $2,000. And I know we talked about some differences among the standards here. We're gonna just use that $2,000 as our initial direct cost amount for all of the standards here when we are applying this into our example. So let's go ahead and get started here with our first step. If you were to do this in Excel yourself to try to calculate this IRR function, which is the implicit rate, first thing you're gonna wanna do is set up the schedule headers and periods associated with the lease. So we said this is a five-year lease, but the payments are occurring as of the beginning of each year, meaning in this case, we're gonna have a period zero where there's gonna be some activity. And so there's gonna be payments in that period zero. And then we also have at the end this period five, there's not going to be any lease payments occurring at that time, but you're going to have a residual value or unguaranteed residual value that's being estimated at the end of the lease. So we've numbered our periods 0 through 5 here, and also added headers for those additional items or components that make up our schedule. The fair value here, the unguaranteed residual value, those initial direct costs by the lessor, and then those payments in advance. So these are all the cash flows that we're going to use to come up with the net cash flow. And from that, we're going to be able to calculate the implicit rate using that internal rate of return or IRR function within Excel. All right. So now all we need to do is start plugging in those different facts. So we mentioned that the fair value of the asset at the beginning of the lease is $15,000. So we're going to plug that $15,000 into a period zero, because this is right at the start of the lease. And it's going to be a negative value here. Now, the reason that this is a negative value is because we're thinking about this as the lessor, right? So this is, you know, a negative cash flow for them because they're essentially losing that value to the lessee. And so it's going to be a negative cash flow in that very first period. All right, next step here is we're going to input the residual value. And so this is the estimated value that the lessor is going to basically get back with this asset, that the asset is going to be worth as of the end of the lease. So in this case, it was $1,000. And you're seeing that this is getting input as of period five. So this is essentially as of the end of the lease. And so that $1,000 is coming back to the lessor with that value. So it's going to be a positive amount as a positive cash flow for the lessor. All right. Now we have our input of initial direct costs here. And the initial direct costs are costs made by the lessor to, you know, get into the lease that wouldn't have been incurred otherwise. So the initial direct costs are a cash outflow or a negative value here for the lessor. So they're going to input that as a negative $2,000. And this occurred before the lease started. So in that period zero, again, this is the initial direct cost of the lessor to get the lease going. All right, our next step here is the actual payments themselves. So we mentioned that this was a 5-year lease with $4,000 payments that are made in advance at the beginning of each year. And so those are positive cash flows for the lessor because they're going to be receiving those payments in advance. And they're starting in the period zero because that first payment and all the other payments are being made as of the beginning of the year or in advance. And so we don't have one happening at the end of the lease. So there's a zero in that period five, indicating that we have made those 5 payments in advance for all of the other years. All right. Next, what we're going to do is calculate the net cash flow. So we're going to use this to figure out the internal rate of return on all of these different inputs. And so what you would need to do is sum the values on the left column. So the fair value, initial direct cost, payments in advance, amount to negative 13. And then we have the other items here, those other positive cash flows of 4,000 up until that period five, where you have a positive cash flow of 1,000. So we need to figure out what the net cash flow is for these values to come up with the internal rate of return based on the cash flows for the lessor. So how do we do that? Well, what you're gonna do in Excel is you're gonna sum the columns or the tabs here that have those net cash flows. So those cells are going to be your net cash flow based on the other information. So you're going to type equals IRR to use this internal rate of return function on those different cells, summing them together. And that's going to give us what our implicit interest rate is based on the terms of our lease. So what is that? Well, in this case, it happens to be 11%. And so this 11.01% is the IRR and also the implicit rate based on the information in our lease. All right. So the very first box in that formula was to calculate the present value of our lease payment. So what we're going to do is we're going to use that implicit rate that we just figured out with the IRR function, the 11.01%, and we're going to plug this into this present value calculation to see what we come up with. So Up at the top on the right side, you see that there's a number of periods. That's our lease term, which is our 5-year lease term. We're going to plug in our IRR of 11.01%. The periods that we're going to be using are in years. Those payments were made annually, and they were made at the beginning of the period. And so, again, you're going to see that period zero here as well, since they're made in advance. And we're going to plug that $4,000 payment that's being made over that 5-year period into this sheet here, and it'll come up with a present value for us of these payments of $16,407. So that was the left side, that very first bubble in our formula. The second is the present value of the expected or unguaranteed residual value. Now, this is one value as of the end of the lease term. This is the amount that the lessor expects the asset to be worth at the end of the lease. So we're going to still have 5 periods here when we plug this into our tool, and the 11.01%. Here's are still going to be the periods, but the payment here, we're going to select that this is made at the end of the period because this is the value at the end of the lease, the very end. So those payments before were happening at the beginning of each period. This valuation is happening at the end of the lease, so we need to select payment made at the end of the period and plug in what that estimated increment or the estimated residual value was here, or the expected residual value, which was $1,000, and figure out the present value of that sum amount, which by plugging it into this tool, you can see that it is $593. All right. So now what we're going to do, again, to further validate this information, is to plug all of our numbers into our formula here. And so we're going to start with that left-hand side. We just figured out that the present value of the lease payments using the 11.01% is $16,407. We also decided that the present value of the expected future value or the expected residual value of the asset, that $1,000 present value, is $593 using that same 11.01%. So that's what we needed to apply the implicit rate to. And now we just plug in the other values. So our fair value, which was $15,000, and we didn't have any investment tax credit, and the initial direct cost here, which we're going to assume are $2,000. So does the left side of the equation equal the right side of the equation? Yes, $17,000 does in fact equal $17,000, which means that we have fully validated our implicit rate here of 11.01, which we found by using the internal rate of return function within Excel. All right, so I want to pause here for a moment and step back, because what we were just doing was, if you were to manually calculate your implicit rate, again, as the lessor, you may have those inputs, or you should have those inputs in order to calculate yourself. The lessee will not most of the time have that information readily available. But if that looked like a lot to you, I mean, it was, you know, 10 or so slides and a lot of different steps, and it can get a little complicated, I would like to recommend one of our free tools that is going to be coming out soon called the Implicit or Lease Rate Implicit tool. And so what this will actually allow you to do is to plug in those different inputs that are required in those formulas. So you'll name the lease, you'll plug in the dates or the term of the lease, that fair value, your payment information, the residual value, and it will actually give you the results and calculate the implicit rate for you without having to go through that process of figuring out the IRR using that Excel, you know, template, and then validating that information with the present value calculator.
We're going to go ahead and jump into our very last topic today, which is really getting around best practices in terms of the application of these rates, or how you should approach this topic. So, what essentially the first question that may come into play is why the implicit rate may not be readily determinable. There is one of two scenarios. First one is you may be dealing with specialized assets, like maybe airport terminals or certain types of real estate and so on and so forth, and you may not be able to determine the market terms of those assets and require the help of some consultants. So that may be one area where it may be difficult. The other area may be from internal metric, from the standpoint of the lessor, the lessee. You may require judgment as the lessor as to how you would apply this rate. But at the end of the day, you know, as we've highlighted, the implicit rate would be a requirement of the lessor to determine. But from the lessee standpoint, that information is rarely disclosed. If you were to approach your lessor today, they probably wouldn't be as privy to share that information with you as you would imagine. And there may be some other variable factors going into it, as Rachel has outlined in term when we calculated that example there. If that was a little strenuous on in terms of the calculations we saw today, then from that standpoint, especially if you have a sizable portfolio, the implicit rate may not be the route that you want to go down. And in reality, as we've mentioned, a lot of our clients, the vast majority of our clients, go down the route of using an incremental borrowing rate instead of an implicit rate.